Okay, got a fun little segment to round out chapter 2 in the book. Sorry, cold went to my chest. The question is, instrumentation amplifiers are really cool. They're one of the coolest type of op-amp circuits we have. It's just really able to take, with high input impedance, take a small difference between two signals, amplify that, output the difference between those two signals. The question is, almost always, is, you know, what gain do we want to use for that? One of the challenges is, a lot of times when we're dealing with a signal that's actually a signal that we're measuring in a real system, so instrumentation amplifiers almost always are used with actual transducers. There's a lot of things that we're sensing with transducers that vary across very large scales. So for instance, the intensity of light. The intensity of light in a room versus the intensity of light outside on a sunny day in Arizona, the difference between those two brightness intensities can be a factor of 100, right? We can have a very large difference between brightness, and of course our bodies can adjust to it by, you know, adjusting or dilating our pupils and adjusting our our sort of internal chemical gain to these signals. But also, how would we do that in the case of where we have a fixed amplifier? We have a circuit on a board. We don't want to have to just quickly swap in resistors if, let's say, we're measuring light and we want to have a nice sensitive measurement of the light inside, but we also want to walk outside and get a nice sensitive measurement. We want to be able to keep that sensitivity, which means we're going to have to change our gain. We're going to have to substantially increase our gain when we're indoors, decrease our gain when we're outdoors. How can we do that without swapping out resistors? Well, one of the cool things that you can find, and these are available to purchase right now, you go on DigiKey, find them, is digitally controllable instrumentation amplifiers, where the gain is controlled digitally. It's actually very easy to build a circuit that will do this kind of digital gain control. So here we have a circuit. This is just a standard three amplifier op-amp design, like what we showed a couple videos ago. But it has here, instead of, remember those three resistors we had here? We had RG and then we had R3 and R3 in our previous circuit. Well, in this case, we're controlling sort of where we set the ratios of these. So what we have is we have a series of gates, and these gates can be controlled digitally. So we can close these gates. They're FETs that we can use. We can close these gates to close the connection between anywhere within this chain of resistors. And let's consider what happens here. So let's consider the case where we close these gates. If we close these gates, what is the resistance, that R3 value? Well, that R3 value we had in the previous equation is now going to be R1 plus R2 plus R3. And the R3 value here, R1 plus R2 plus R3. And that RG value, that RG value is going to be this R4 here. So in that case, we are going to have a very high ratio of R3 to RG. And you can see what that does to the equations that we showed previously. I'm not going to put them back up here. But let's close a different switch. What if we close this switch here? If we close this switch here, now what we have is R3 is going to be R1 plus R2. R3 is going to be R1 plus R2. And now the equivalent of RG is going to be R3 plus R4 plus R3. So by choosing a different switch to close, we've now shrunk the value of R3 and increased the value of RG. And we can do this with any number of resistors, as long as we have these separate digital switches, and they allow us to change these ratios to dynamically change the gain of an instrumentation amplifier. So we can now have a circuit, let's say we are amplifying a signal from a bridge that's got a very sensitive photoresistor that's measuring the intensity of light. And let's say we have a microcontroller that is now reading the analog value coming off of this instrumentation amplifier. And that microcontroller sees that the analog value coming out saturated. It reached its max. What we could do with something like this is that microcontroller could send a digital signal then to this amplifier and say, let's scale back the gain. And after it scales back the gain, it can then check the output. And if that output is not saturated, it can say, okay, this is my output value, but now I know, based on the signal that I sent to this, what gain value this should have. And so I know in software what I should multiply this by to get the actual value I'm looking at. The flip side is, if you're the microcontroller and the signal you're getting is really tiny, you might then send a different signal to this amplifier to increase the gain to get the value to be somewhere more within a range where you know you're getting a good sensitivity of measurement when reading that. And then again, you would know what the gain was that you had set, and you'd be able to, in software, multiply that by it to get the difference here. This is very common. Controllable gains happen all the time, and they're very useful for things like that. They're mostly useful for things that have a large dynamic range, where a signal that we're measuring is going to vary over many orders of magnitude, and we still care about the strength of that signal at small magnitudes and big magnitudes. We still want to have that same precision, even across orders of magnitude of scale change. Okay. I'm going to show you another little nifty gadget. That is if we go back to our and I'm not going to fully flesh in all the details here. Just note, this stage had all the resistor combinations that we had in the initial stage of the three op-amp instrumentation amplifier. We're mainly going to focus on the second stage here, though. So this second stage looks like this. Where we had some resistor ratio, R1, R2, setting the gain in the second stage. Again, there is still the first stage, I just don't want to flesh it out. So, this is the way our previous design was on this second stage. But what we can do is, this sort of a design will give us an output voltage, which is an amplified difference of the input signals relative to ground. It's relative to ground because we have R2 grounded over here. But it turns out that this signal here gives us a nifty tool that we can use to set a value other than ground as our reference. So that means that the signal that is output here will be an amplified difference between the input signals relative to some new value that is specified by the signal at this location. So for instance, if we put a 4-volt signal here, this output would be the difference multiplied by some gain set by that resistor RG plus 4 volts. Why do we want this offset? When does this offset come in handy? One of the biggest things is when we have a single-sided device like a microcontroller, like a standard CMOS analog to digital converter, which is single-sided. My apologies. So it has an input range of, say, 0 to 5 volts, or 0 to 3.3 volts, or 0 to 1.8 volts. When we have that single-sided operation, looking at a differential signal is something where we have to convert that positive-negative differential signal into a fully positive signal. And the best way to do that usually is to add some offset. So amplify and offset, remove offset and amplify are two things we do all the time with op-amp circuits and with instrumentation amplifiers. And again, it's because in the real world, in the physical world, signals are quite often bidirectional. If you have a strain gauge on a steel beam and you push it one way or push it the other way, that signal is going to go positive, negative. But if you're measuring that with a microcontroller, the microcontroller does not operate with a negative rail. The microcontroller is only going to be able to sense positive differential signals. So in order to guarantee that your output signal will always stay positive, you're going to want to add some offset. Again, that offset can be subtracted off in software later on, or whatever system you're using can later subtract that off. But as we move from dual-sided operation to single-sided operation, we have to quite often add offsets. This makes it an easy way to do it. One caveat about adding offsets here, though. This offset, we can't just create this offset voltage using a voltage divider. Right? A lot of times it's tempting to say, okay, I want a 1.65 volt offset here. So we say, all right, I'm going to take my 3.3 volt reference, and I'm going to do a 10K and a 10K, and I'm going to say, okay, now I got 1.65 volts here.
No.
We don't want to do that. Why don't we want to do that? Stop the video, talk amongst yourselves, think to yourself, why wouldn't you want to do that? Okay, so hopefully you came up with the problem with this approach is the output resistance of this voltage supply is way too high. The output resistance of this voltage supply will have an effect on the equivalent resistance of R2, which will throw this into imbalance, which will cause this to not function properly. Instead, what we need to do is we need to have a very low output impedance supply of this voltage here, so it doesn't affect the operation of this amplifier. Now, we still like doing that voltage divider to get halfway between, say, a 0 and a 3.3 volt source. So sometimes one of the best things to do, is to just do something like this. So sometimes the best thing to do is just buffer this, buffer your signal that you created with the voltage divider using another op amp, drive the reference pin, drive the offset pin, and then use that to produce your offset. So, but you gotta be very careful with offset pins. Offset pins often require a strong regulated supply. You can't just use a signal voltage produced by a resistor divider. Some, if you pay a little bit more, some of these amplifiers will already have this built in, and then you can do that, but you have to be very careful to know which one you have. A lot of times, people can also, you can buy this off the shelf, it wouldn't just be splitting a rail, it would actually have a fixed voltage, but you can buy a voltage reference off the shelf too that will provide a strong low impedance output voltage signal that can be just used to directly drive this. So you could buy a 1.65 volt voltage reference and use that circuit in here instead of doing your own using this kind of a configuration. But the key takeaway is, cool thing is, we can use this pin as an offset. The caveat is that offset has to be driven by a strong signal. So, but it's a really nifty way to add offset to a signal. One quick thing before we finish here, this is really all I've got that I want to cover in chapter 2. But one quick thing before we finish that I want to mention is the problems in the book, a lot of the problems in the book refer to converting, when you do a current to voltage converter or a voltage to current converter, they quite often say, take a signal that is 4 milliamps to 20 milliamps and convert it to a 0 to 10 volt signal. Right? There's a reason, that's not arbitrary. The 4 to 20 milliamp standard and the 0 to 10 volt standard are standard signaling used for analog signals in mostly industrial applications, automotive as well. And why, does anybody know why you might have a signal that's a current signal, 4 amp to 20 milliamp signal? So think about why you might use a current signal, and then pause the video and then think about it, and then come back to me. Okay, so the biggest reason that we would use a current signal is in industrial applications, quite often the wires that are carrying a signal are very long. Very long wires carrying an analog signal. And so let's say we have a voltage signal, 0 to 10 volts. All right, so we have some, let's do it like this. A voltage signal here. And we have some piece of equipment at the other end that's going to be receiving this signal. The problem is, in this case, if this is a voltage signal, if there is any amount of current flowing through these wires, if there's any amount of current to carry this signal flowing through these wires, That current will cause a drop of this voltage due to the length of the wire. So we'll have resistive losses. That voltage will become attenuated by the resistance in this cable. So the voltage signal, that we have 10 volts here, and we might only have 9.2 volts over here, if it's a very long cable, very resistive cable. So to solve that problem, a lot of industrial applications, a lot of automotive industrial signaling applications said, let's drive a current. Let's drive a fixed current, and if you drive a fixed current, so if we have a current supply, that current supply, it doesn't matter how much resistance we have in these wires, whatever current we have here will be the current we get at the other end. So that's the reason that people sometimes use current signaling. Nowadays, for the most part, whatever is sampling a voltage at the other end should have probably a very high input impedance. So there's usually, even in voltage signals that are carried nowadays, we don't generally have a lot of current associated with it. That presents problems with its own, though. You have very long cables with very high resistances between them. You're very susceptible to noise. You're going to have a lot of capacitance. You're going to be very susceptible to noise. So that also has its own set of issues. But just to keep in mind, the reason for a current, a 4 to 20 milliamp current signal, is a 4 to 20 milliamp current signal is something that is resilient to these sorts of noises that you would encounter in an industrial environment. So that's the reason for it. It is a very common standard. The 4 to 20 and 0 to 10 is still standards that are used to this very day. You can buy sensors that use those standards all over the place. And conversion between the two is still very important. So that's the reason for those problems. I just wanted to give you a heads up for it. So, all right, thank you, everybody. That concludes chapter 2.